Come in. Mr. Kelvin.
Yeah, thank you.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for having me.
No problem. So, I've gone through your proposal. Looks okay, but do me this. My company is the largest importers of generators. So, how does this deal benefit us?
Okay, we plan to appoint your company as the lead supplier for Southwestern region.
Okay, numbers please.
Okay, it will interest you to know that the global renewable energy market is estimated to gross over $800 billion by this year's end, with an annual growth rate of 10.03% from 2013.
And for Nigeria?
Well, Richard Braxton, I know you know him, estimated that Nigerian alternate energy market will hit $10 billion.
Oh, no, that's good then.
This is a beautiful opportunity for your company.
So $10 billion for the whole of Nigeria.
I'm telling
that's
you.
Promising. So
good.
Here's the thing.
Okay.
I love this proposal. I love the numbers, but we need to talk to the CEO.
Okay, where's the CEO so we can close this deal?
He will be here soon and we'll sort all this out. No problem.
Okay, okay.
Here he is. So just hold on.
Let's do this. No, don't worry. I will surprise you once the whole thing is done. Oh, Mrs. Cole? Yeah, she's there. Oh, speak to the senator.
Okay. Hello, Senator.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes. Hi. Yes, sir.
What, sir?
We just won the contract from the senator.
Oh, that's great news.
Very great one. To supply them with 10,000 units of generators to the east, another 10,000 to the west.
Oh, that's one. Yes. So here's the thing. Good news everywhere. Initiative here. We have the chance to go through our proposal.
That's your job.
Okay. Kelvin is here.
Oh, so, Kelvin.
Oh, the pleasure is mine, sir.
Yes, thank you. Welcome. So are we making the supply now? When are we starting?
No, actually, you're the one that is going to be generating power for your consumers.
Okay, with our generators, I think.
No, it's called the Renewable Energy Project. What we do is that we'll harness all resources that we'll have. We'll have waste, we'll have sunlight, we'll have water. We're going to use this to generate 24-hour non-stop power supply for all Nigerians.
Wow. That's like 20,000 units of generators each local government. Wow, I'm loving this.
Sir.
I love it.
No need for generators anymore.
What?
What do you mean?
Senator, please let me call you back. What did I just hear? No need for generators, Mr. Maron. What are you listening to?
Repeat yourself, Mr. Man.
Madam, this is the future.
Wait, please. Future of where?
Madam,
what?
I think you need to
tell me, shut up.
It's 24-hour non-stop power supply for all Nigerians.
Nigeria, are you in JJC? You just come. Nigeria, nothing works. 24 hours light. Mr. Maron, we have a meeting now. Listen to
me. Will you keep quiet?
This is the future.
Keep quiet. We just won a contract from the Senate.
Come on.
To supply them with 10,000 units.
Mr. Maron, 35,000.
Yes, 35,000 units of generators. And you're here talking this rubbish with this man.
Please, see
is
to
this
it.
What I pay you for?
Mr. Maron, let's have the meeting. Nonsense. 24 hours light. Jokers.
Kelvin.
Be fast about
I'm
it,
sorry
please.
About that. Okay. I'll see you off. So here's the thing. I really love this project. And I think... Just fill me in with every detail you have.
Okay, let's have a drink and, you know, discuss this.
No problem.
Okay.
Feel free.
With the numbers.
Oh.
Sorry, I kept you waiting.
Oh. Welcome.
Yes.
Maron.
Yes.
Clara Plastics.
Yes, I spoke with the MD.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's my very good
friend.
Yeah. I want them to start collecting diesel from the company. And this company, they consume
66 liters weekly.
66,000?
Isn't that a good one?
That's a good default. Oh, just a minute.
All right.
Jumokel, please be fast. I don't have TV in front of me. Can you just tell me what's up? What? What? Say that again. Press conference, where? Get off my phone.
What's going on?
Mr. Moron, please stop asking me questions and follow me. Just follow me.
Press conference. Oh.
Oh, it is a done deal already. You see, the federal government has commissioned the Power for All initiative to bring in together all stakeholders. You know, they have been commissioned to start the first phase of the project. So we have all business owners in the power sector, all generator importers and what have you. They are all involved in this project. We have so many people on this project. I don't see this project staying back. We are going to move with this project. There's nothing stopping us at all.
Hearing on the sudden ban of generator importation, news have gotten to us that business owners in that sector are complaining. Don't you see this as a major threat to the success of this project?
Not at all. As I said, the federal government gave the Power of All initiative the upper hand on this project. You see, one of the prerequisites for this project was for the Power for All initiative to bring in all stakeholders. I mean, all business owners in the power sector. We gave them enough time. We gave them enough information. We got them to invest in this project. So if there is any business owner who feels like this has a sudden impact on them, it's because they were not prepared. You know, preparedness is key. We cannot keep waiting for everybody to be involved in this project before we go on. We've been waiting for this thing for too long. It's time for Nigeria to have 24 hours light. So anybody that is not a part of the project, it was not just prepared. We can't wait for anybody, please. Okay, let me have.
What is the guarantee that the implementation of this project will be as planned?
I think Mr. White can answer that question.
Okay. Thank you, Honorable. First of all, I want to thank everyone for supporting this initiative, despite all odds. We want to say a big thank you to the Nigerian government for making this tough call, you know, in the interest of all Nigerians. Now to your question. I'm happy to inform you that the technology for this initiative is already in the country. Yes, so this change is actually for real. And unfortunately, the ship has sailed for those who did not catch it. Thank you.
I think we've had enough questions. Thank you. Thank you.
Please, Mr. Moron, be fast. So slow.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Minister Ma. Minister Ma.
I'm really happy that you brought me.
Minister Ma. So I need to. Ma, what about our contract?
Please, that contract is canceled.
No. It can be canceled. Mr. Kelvin,
oh, sorry, I have a call, please.
Femi, can I speak with you?
No problem.
Yes. You know, anything that happens to our company actually affects the both of us.
Oh, you mean your company?
Our company. Oh. So I want to ask, if there is a way our company can still be part of this program.
I'm really sorry about that. You specifically said no to this.
Yes.
That ship has sailed.
I said no before, but now I'm saying yes. Like, we can still work things out. We can still fix this.
You should have been on time. I'm really sorry. I have to go.
You can't go. Fanny, you can't leave me.
Let's meet up with the minister.
You can't leave me now. I said get out. Don't come close to me. Oh, God. Loan. Billions of naira loan collected from the bank. How do I pay back?
Mr. Maron.
This can't happen.
When the landscape was changing, you were not prepared.
Prepared. Landscape.
Are you a business owner?
I finished. No. How do I?
Disruption is coming.
Oh.
Are you ready as a business owner for that wonderful career? Is globalization outpacing your skills and capacity? A question for you. And above everything, as a believer sitting here this evening, how are you redeeming the time? Thank you.
Hallelujah. Okay. So I'd just like to ask you very quickly, thank you. Okay, so I hope that there are Mr. Moron sitting in the audience tonight. Mr. Is it Maron or Moron? Hallelujah. Amen. I mean, you see, this things happen all the time. You know, I stumbled on something, and I don't remember the exact details, but not about, I think in the late 70s, early 80s, 1960s. All right, can I? Thank you, Pastor. Hallelujah. All right, so I read something that suggested that when the telephone was being invented, and the man who invented the telephone was going to register the patent, or he was applying for the patent. I think the man who was in charge of registering patents in the United States in those days, right, said something that sounded like all inventions that could be invented have been invented, right? So, guys, just go away. Nothing new can be thought of. And so think about somebody in 1950 or 1960 saying that everything that could be invented had been invented, right? And think between then and now, the number of things that have been invented, yeah? Think about cell phone, think about social media, think about all kinds of things that have been. So my point this evening, just again, like that, play points out, right, is this. Pay attention, all right? You need to always be alert to opportunities, okay? Don't write things off, and then you will be able to make progress. Hallelujah. All right, so this evening we'll continue in our new series, talking about super stories, okay? And we want to just welcome everybody who is joining us online, all right? Either church members who couldn't make it this evening, or people who are joining us from different parts of the world, all right? We'll say a very warm welcome to you. We believe that God is with you where you are. And his word is coming in your direction, and it's going to make significant impact in your life in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, so turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25. I'm going to read from verse 1 through to 13. It's a bit of a long read, so I want you to pay attention. So verse 1 says, "Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins, who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. But while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, a cry was heard. Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said to the wise, give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out. But the wise answered, saying, no, lest there should not be enough for us and you. But go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. And those who were ready went in with him to the wedding. And the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, assuredly, I say to you, I do not know you. Verse 13 says, watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. Hallelujah. Ephesians chapter 5, I'm going to read verses 15 through 17 in the Message translation. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15. It says, so watch your steps, use your head, make the most of every chance you get. Can you change that to Message translation, please? Yeah. Watch your step, use your head, make the most of every chance you get. These are desperate times. Don't live carelessly, unthinkingly. Make sure you understand what the master wants. All right, can we read it together? Just put it on the screen. Everybody, just I want you to read it to your neighbor. Yeah? Read it to your neighbor from verse 15. Can it be on the screen, please? No, verse 15. Look in the light of Christ. Look up in verse 2. Next. Okay, I think, don't worry. I'm just going to read it from here one more time. Looks like we're missing it. Ephesians 5, verse 15 to 17. So, watch your step, use your head, make the most of every chance you get. These are desperate times. Don't live carelessly, unthinkingly. Make sure you understand what the master wants. Hallelujah. All right, so this evening, we're talking about another story, okay? And this one, we're talking about a story of preparedness, okay? Story of preparedness. That's what we're talking about and focusing on this evening. I mean, you saw an example of that, you know, from the play that we just watched about 10 minutes ago. And now reading this parable that Jesus told. Now, the truth is, when Jesus told this parable, and he told this to both his disciples and the people who were listening to him, he used the parable to illustrate and say to them, by way of prophecy, what it will be like, all right, when the time of the end of age has come, when Jesus will come back, all right? Because if you read chapter 24 of the book of Matthew, the closing verses of it, that was the conversation he was having with his disciples. And then he used this parable as an example to illustrate and tell them a story that they could relate to. Now, the second context of the parable is this. Let me explain to you the historical context of that parable. You see, in Israel, in those days, and I probably believe maybe up until now, perhaps it still happens, when a wedding ceremony is going to happen, yeah? So the groom comes and chooses his bride, and they get betrothed, what you will call they get engaged, all right? And so after they have gotten engaged, okay, the groom goes away, and then he comes back on a certain day when they have agreed that he will come back. So he comes back, right? And then what happens is that the bride is waiting for him along with a group of her friends, okay? And those are the ones that this story refers to as virgins. So, this group of friends will be waiting at the bride's residence, okay? Waiting for the groom to come and lead them in a procession to the venue of the wedding party, which most likely will be the groom's place, okay? And in those days, most of the times, these things were done in the evening. And that was why they needed lamps, okay? So, the bride and her friends will be waiting for the groom. And then the groom will come, and then everybody will be excited. They will carry their lamps and file out in a procession of dancing and excitement and joy, okay, to the venue of the party. And then when they get there, they go in, and then they join the party. Now, holding a lamp in some context, right, was like your ticket to be on the bridal train, So if you didn't have a lamp, you couldn't participate in that walk and dance from the home of the bride to the home of the groom. Which was why when the groom came and the virgins who didn't have enough oil, they realized that they didn't have enough oil and they had to find a way of getting more oil. Otherwise, all right, if having enough oil to power your lamp wasn't important, they could just have allowed their lamps to go off and they would have gone in. But it was very crucial and critical that your lamp be on and you needed oil to put on to keep the lamp running. Now, if you don't understand that context of the oil and the lamp, how many people have used kerosene lantern before? Jesus Christ. Okay. Oh, yeah, you're there. Thank you very much. How many people have used kerosene stove before? Aha, okay, all right. So at some point in my life, I was a semi-expert, you know, at managing the kerosene stove, making sure that the wicks, all right, those thread, those things that looked like thread, thick white like this, yeah, that they were well trimmed. There is a way that they could become so short that they are no longer able to touch the kerosene in the tank. They can't suck in the kerosene and then you can't cook whatever it is they are cooking. And then God bless you if you had started cooking a pot of beans or rice and then the tank runs out of kerosene, Jesus Christ. It means that you're likely not going to have food that day, or by the time you finish refueling the tank of the kerosene stove, yeah, your rice or your beans would have soaked water already. I mean, it becomes soggy and all of that, yeah? So think about it. Now let me bring you a slightly more contemporary example and context. How many of you in this wonderful, nice looking handbags they are carrying have a tiny little thing called power banks? How many people have power banks in their cars, in their bags? Okay, all right. So think about that lamp as your power bank, or think about it as the charger for your laptop. Okay, so you're going to work and you left the power pack for your laptop in your house. Okay? And then, of course, you will start work in the morning, and then for like 1 hour or 1.5 hours or 2 hours, you're fine. And then after a while, you will see one small blue indicator on your laptop, on your screen. Irrespective of what you are doing, it just come up and says, battery is about to run out, yeah? Connect to your power source. Okay. And God bless you if you had left the power pack at home, and everybody around you is using HP or Dell computers, and you have your very fanciful MacBook, all right? And so they cannot lend you the power packs of their HPs or their Dell computers to power your MacBook. Hallelujah. So I want you to think, that is the exact scenario that these people found themselves in. And so this evening, for the next 20, 25, 30 minutes, we're going to be exploring a few principles, all right, from that story. Now, I've explained to you that Jesus used this as a parable to depict when he will come back, okay, in rapture to come and take the church home. But I'm also saying tonight we're using it as a story to extract principles and lessons from, to teach and to learn something from it that talks about being prepared, that talks about taking advantage of opportunities, that talks about not being lazy, that talks about thinking ahead and not just living for today. And so the first thing I wanted to understand from that story is this, is that all the virgins were pre-qualified, but not all of them were adequately prepared. Acts that they had been chosen for. Perhaps they had the same kinds of degrees. They probably, if you were to look at their CVs, you will see very likely that they were all maybe chartered accountants, or they had all had MBAs, they had gone to Ivy League schools and all of that. So on the surface of it, it looked like an advantage, an opportunity that all of them were suited to take advantage of. But you see, the challenge is that the key to success in that assignment was not just what they knew to do as at the time that they were chosen. It wasn't just what they had the capacity to be able to achieve. It is about thinking ahead and being ready for the future. Hallelujah. And so one thing that you must understand is that it is very painful to be the person who almost made it. Hallelujah. I almost made it. It's not the same thing as I made it. So you don't want to be that person who was the They said this thing would start at 10 a.m. This person got there at 10:05 a.m. and they had shut the door. So you have to position yourself at every time in life and every phase of your life not to be that person who almost made it. Hallelujah. And so you see, the thing is that the difference between the virgins, yeah, the Bible spoke about five who were wise and five who were foolish. The key difference between them was in the attitude of preparation. Considering the options of the things that you have ahead of you, not only living for today, but preparing to live for tomorrow as well. And that in itself is a demonstration, significant demonstration of maturity. And so bringing it to our everyday life, I mean, you know that next year or in 6 months' time or in 9 months' time, you know, you will need to pay rent for the place where you are living right now. And you know you have a job. So it's not like you don't have a job. You have a job. Then you must begin to save for your rent from today onward. So that when the time comes for you to issue a check or to make a transfer to the bank account of your landlord, all right, you are not stammering. Amen. I mean, from time to time, I come across one or two people who come and say, oh, look, my wife is about to have a baby, you know, and money to pay hospital bills. And I'm like, okay, well, thank you very much. Christmas doesn't just come suddenly. All of us know the dates, 25th of December. This woman has been pregnant for 9 months. How come it is today that she's due to go to the hospital? That we've then suddenly discovered we don't have. Oh no, but I've been running around. I mean, my father said they were going to help me. My uncle said they will help me. It's okay. When did you start talking to them? Well, I called my older brother, that one with day Germany. I called him 2 days ago. No, it's not 2 days ago that is the issue. So that attitude, and I'm not saying from time to time people don't need help, right? But my point is this, that even when you need help with something, to achieve something that you are setting out to do, you want to set out early enough to be able to make sure that you are ready. Hallelujah. And so I'm speaking around a few things to note. And so first, I've spoken about the virgins, the way that they behaved, the way that they positioned themselves to be able to execute this assignment and take advantage of the opportunity to be able to attend this very important party. And so all of them were willing, they were capable of doing what was asked of them, but not all of them were ready to do what was asked of them. And so the truth is, nobody starts out to fail. Nobody. It's only the way that we prepare for and undertake the journey that determines whether we will make it. Hallelujah. So two people may set out from here this evening to say that we're going to Ibadan. And one person leaves this place with a car with a full tank of fuel. Another person leaves this place with a car that has less than one quarter fuel. In fact, the orange line that shows you that you need to buy fuel as tire showing. And you say, okay, don't worry, I'm going. When I get to toll gate, I'll buy fuel. And then you get to toll gate at 9 p.m. and those ones said, we close at 8:45 p.m. And then you keep going. When I get to Jodubega, I'll buy fuel. And then you get there, Total petrol station said, oh no, we're out of fuel. And then common sense still doesn't say, stop and look for fuel. Okay? And you say, don't worry, I'm going. The God of miracles is my father. And man, you will sleep on the express. And God help you. That you don't get harassed by armed robbers. And so the next thing that I want to talk about is you noticed from the story that there was a period called the waiting period. So the Bible says that the bridegroom delayed in coming. I don't like to be late. Yeah? I like to be prompt. I like things to start on time and to end on time. But a good number of times, you know, you will find that circumstances and things happen that make it almost kind of like, look, things are not running according to plan. So what is your capacity to survive in times of uncertainty? Hallelujah. One of the things that I hate most of my life is uncertainty, things that I don't have control over. I mean, I've grown and I've learned to be able to manage them. I remember in the days when I was working in consulting, if we had a client presentation in the client office, right? And we would have called to confirm, do you have a projector? Yes. Do you have a projector screen? Yes. So we don't need to bring our own. They say, yes, everything is fine. I was that guy. We will still carry our own projector screen, our own projector, put it in the boot of my car. In fact, test it the night before the presentation, okay? And then the morning of the presentation, test it again to make sure that it is still working. Nothing has happened to it. And then carry it along with me to the venue of the presentation in case something goes wrong. Most of the times, nothing ever went wrong, but there was one day when something went wrong. And the fact that I had something in my boots made me look like a star. So you want to do as much as you can in the season, in the waiting season, the seasons of uncertainty in life. And let me break it down. So your job, or you're doing a business, or whatever it is that you are doing, and you're coasting along, you become an expert at what you are doing. You can do it almost in your dreams, right? And you're waiting for a promotion. Promotion hasn't come. You're doing what you're doing. It looks like it's going okay. Ladies and gentlemen, what is the next level for you? You are in a waiting season. When you are in that waiting season, what you are supposed to be doing is to make sure that you are prepared for the opportunity that you are pursuing. Because when the time for the opportunity comes and you don't have the capacity to fulfill the opportunity, nobody is going to wait for you. Hallelujah. So the matriculation day is not the day to go and write jamb. Yeah? Matriculation day is the day of celebrating the people who passed jamb already. So if you didn't sit for the exam, there's no way you're going to get a result. If you didn't prepare for it, there's no way you're going to get a good result. So it's important to anticipate the unexpected and plan for the rainy day. It is extremely important to anticipate the unexpected and plan for the rainy day. And that is why you hear things like, don't eat all that you earn. Make plans for the rainy day. January, before it begins to rain in March. Hallelujah. If you wait till March, the umbrella would have become more expensive than it was in January or in December. Hallelujah. So while these virgins were waiting, especially the foolish one, when they, you know, think about it. So I don't think that all 10 of them came from the same home. I don't think that they are sisters. So most likely they are friends. And then everybody came, you know, like you people would do. How many people did bridesmaid 2 weeks ago? 3 weeks ago. Thank you very much. So you know how all of you will gather, carry your bag and meet, you know, at whether it's the hotel or the house of the bride or wherever it is, and everybody has come with your dresses and everything and your shoes. So just think that the wedding is at 10 a.m. and it's at 9:45 a.m. When the father of the bride is saying, everybody get into the car, let's go to church, that's when you realize that your dress needs to be ironed. You can't do that with my In fact, my father is kind of person where, I've heard people tell me before. I know one person told me and said the day that I was getting married, we left my mother at home. Because my father said, we're leaving home at 9:30. Wedding is at 11 a.m. When it was 9:27, he showed up and said, everybody march into the car. My mother was Steiner Gilly. We got into the car, and we zoomed off. You know, I've heard those sort of stories before. And I've seen it happen even when we're conducting wedding ceremonies in church. So it's not the last minute. So my point is this. Those 10 people met at the house of the bride. The five that were called foolish, they saw the five that were wise with their extra jars of oil. And they still didn't think to say, do we need oil? I didn't bring extra. Should I go and get extra? Should I go and get some more? Peradventure, in fairness to them, they thought, well, grooms usually come very quickly. I think this oil that I have will be enough. But what they also knew, everybody was in that cultural setting, understood the fact that you really could not predict with accuracy when the bridegroom will show up. And so you had to be prepared for eventualities. So ladies and gentlemen, what these guys, they didn't lack capacity. What they lacked was foresight. And so in what area of your life do you need to demonstrate a higher level of ability to show foresight? Hallelujah. How and where? I want you to think about it. Because you don't want your story to be written and then someone begins to say to you that you have behaved foolishly, like one of these people. Hallelujah. Now let's talk about the supply of oil. So remember, we've talked about who? We've talked about the virgins. We'll come back to them again. We've talked about the waiting period, about the fact that there are seasons in our lives where we need to be preparing for tomorrow, where we can't afford to just live for today. And that's why Ephesians chapter 5 says, it says, use your head. And so the supply of oil. You see, there is always something that makes sure that helps you to be able to perform when the season for performance comes. There's always something that you need to prepare ahead. You need to hold extra in store. It may be money, it may be skills, it may be knowledge, it may be wisdom, maybe the ability to pray, whatever it is, there is always something that you have to prepare for the future. And you need to make sure that you put in all of the required efforts to make sure that you stock up on nothing. So what extra effort do you need to put into being distinguished? On your job, wherever you may be, what more do you need to do to stand yourself out, to be able to be ahead of the curve and to stand out from your peers? I read one story where very many years ago, there was one young man who used to work on a construction site. And this guy, workmen running all over the place, all right? So think about somebody who was building a skyscraper, a 13-floor, a 27-floor building. Think about the number of workmen that were there. And so this guy, because all of them were working for the same company, they had the same kind of uniform, all right? And so everybody had to wear their uniforms and to show up. And so it was, if you were looking from a distance, it was difficult to tell who was Tunji, who was Yejide, who was Danladi, and who was Usman. And so this guy will do something. He went and asked for a different color of safety helmet. Yeah? And so everybody was wearing blue safety helmets, and this guy will wear a orange safety helmet. And then we'll make sure that he came in at least 20 minutes before everybody and stayed back at work about 10, 15 minutes after everybody. So it became easy for the foreman to notice him as a hard-working person, as the person who came in first and who left. And so when it was time for promotion, they were going to start another project and they needed a foreman. And so it was easy for someone to say, look, can you bring me that guy? I see him every day coming in early. So at your job, in your business, in everything and anything that you're doing with yourself and your life, how are you positioning to stand out? Hallelujah. So if you don't devote the time and the energy to develop yourself, no one may be able to help you when your opportunity shows up. If you don't think ahead, plan ahead. Don't just live for today. Hallelujah. I mean, and this applies in different areas of life, in character, in technical competencies. You want to become a parent? What do you know about parenting? So you're married, your wife is pregnant. What do you know about how, whatever happens to people in pregnancy? Have you subscribed to Baby Center? And they're sending you emails every week that tells you this is what your wife is likely to, this is how she's likely to behave tomorrow. You need to prepare. Hallelujah. What are my responsibilities as I position for the opportunities God is bringing my way? That's a question. Thing that is powering the lamp. You see, the oil in this context looks like something that you cannot see because you put it in the tank. The only thing you can see the effect of the oil because the light is shining, okay? So the wick that is carrying the light is shining, is the one that is taking the glory. The oil that is doing the work is hidden. But the oil is more important than the light. Without the oil, the light will go off. And you see, the thing is that the oil diminishes over time. And so you need to make the effort to keep storing up oil in every and any area of your life. The skills that you have today are likely to become obsolete and useless in 5 years' time. So you need to keep looking ahead and keep retooling yourself. Don't be like Mr. Moron. He didn't understand where the economy was going. He didn't understand the technology that was coming up. He didn't understand the new developments that were coming up, and he just kept doing what he was doing the same way as it was in the beginning, so is now, and he was expecting will be forevermore. How foolish he was. Don't be Mr. Moron. So you need to keep topping up, study, do something extra, check out what is going on. Hallelujah. Don't stay the same way. Keep reinventing yourself. Keep learning new things. That's the only way that you can stay and show that you're ready to take advantage of opportunities as they're showing up in your lives and in different areas. Hallelujah. So some of the courses that were very lucrative 25 years ago, nobody cares about them anymore. I mean, you know, there was a time where every business needed to have their own accountant. Yeah? These days, almost everybody can download, can do invoice online, download something from the one app from somewhere that helps you to do your bookkeeping. So the bookkeepers, accountants who are behaving like just bookkeepers are getting to be in trouble. Yeah? I mean, my first degree is in accounting, and I'm not shading my professional colleagues. But all I am saying is this. You need to look ahead. Don't stay the same way. Hallelujah. Don't stay the same way for the rest of your lives. Hallelujah. So do something. Do something different. Do something new. Let me tell you one personal story very quickly. The first time ever that I traveled out of Nigeria, I was sent on training to Netherlands, right? And a couple of things used to happen in those days. Number one, if you were traveling out, yeah, in those days, we didn't even have ATM cards, right? Not to think that you would go there and then be able to swipe your card and spend your money that's in your account. You had to have cash. There was something called traveler's checks. How many people remember traveler's checks? You had to go to the bank, you know, take your naira, and then they would give you these things called traveler's checks. And you even had to sign it in their presence. Otherwise, when you get there, you won't be able to use it. So I traveled and I went to this to Netherlands. Yeah? I had some money in my pocket, just fine. I didn't have a problem with money. The problem that I had was with food. And I got there and realized that, Jesus Christ, I could barely find anything that I was able to eat, and I was supposed to be gone for 2 weeks. I mean, in those days, I was fresh out of schools. Salad was not something I was interested in, or whatever it was. And then I didn't have the wisdom to go with Gary and sugar. I mean, thankfully, there was some lady who was clever enough. I mean, so there was some lady whose older sister was like 2 or 3 years ahead of us in the same organization. And this person had told her sister about how, look, it was likely that you find it difficult to eat the food. And so this lady had gone with her own Gary. And then she became everybody's friend. And of course, at some point, this Gary was going to run out. It wasn't going to be enough for everybody. And so somebody had to be very wise to say, well, you know, you can't have any more. And so my staple food for that period was bread. So they give us bread, and when we go for breakfast, you'll see bread. I'll just grab the bread, put some in my room, along with fruits. Because when they gave us lunch, I just couldn't eat it. Even, I mean, it was. Now I am different. If you take me anywhere, I will survive. But I will also go with some Gary, right? Amen. So it speaks to preparation and learning from your experiences. Now, the fourth thing that I wanted to see is the attitude of the different characters in this story. The bridegroom. Let's talk about the bridegroom. Notice that the bridegroom came late. And then when he came, the story didn't say whether he apologized or not. He just moved on and continued to do what he wanted to do. And so he went ahead with people who were ready. And those who were not ready, he didn't care. I mean, so that's how life happens sometimes. So something that you have been expecting and anticipating, it may not happen today that you expected it to happen. It may not happen tomorrow. It may not happen in 6 weeks' time. But he expects that you will be ready and waiting ready for it when the time comes. And so if you are not ready, the opportunity moves on. Nobody will say you have been looking for a job for 6 months. And that's why the day they invited you for an interview, all your shirts and suits had gone to the dry cleaner. And then when you then came, one of them was ironed. And then you couldn't come for the interview because you had no clothes to wear. They will move on and interview the remaining 300 people who showed up well-dressed and were ready for the interview. They will not care that they had been keeping you waiting for 2.5 weeks or 2.5 months. So you need to understand that when life happens, life happens. You are the one who has to be ready. The virgins had no control over when the bridegroom would show up. Hallelujah. So they had to be ready. And it's the same thing. Now think about the attitude of the foolish virgins, the Mr. Morons of this story. The first thing is this, they had a sense, it looked like they had a sense of entitlement. Because when the bridegroom showed up, the first thing they said, and they noticed that their oils were, their lamps were going on, the first thing they said was, they said to the people who had oil, give me some of your own. I mean, that does suggest that you and I are here together, so why can't I have what you have? Give me. Meanwhile, all of us have been sitting down together, playing Ludo, watching Netflix and Telemundo, and you did not say, I don't have oil, let me go and buy the oil. And then they say, give me your own. And he says, these other people were smart enough to say, I'm sorry, I don't think it's going to be enough for all of us. Go and buy your own. All right? So they had this attitude that says, every opportunity will wait for me. It is not true. Time and chance does not wait for anybody. You need to position yourself and be ready when time and chance happens to you. Hallelujah. Also, they did not rightly discern their need and what was required of them. Don't be unprepared for your opportunity. Stop thinking God will sort me out all the time. Hallelujah. Prepare. Prepare for your opportunity. Don't be unprepared. Amen. So look at their attitude and measure yourself and say, this is something I need to walk away from. I need to make sure it does not happen in my life on a regular basis. And of course, it also looked to me like they were only engaged in short-term thinking. Hallelujah. I mean, that lamp could contain was all that they had. So think about your generator. If you put a full tank of fuel in it, how long will it take before it runs out? And then when it's about to run out, and then when the next time you're about to put it on, do you check whether there's fuel in it or not? Otherwise, it will shut down. Hallelujah. So don't be careless. Don't engage in short-term thinking. And then I want you to look at the wise virgins. I have just a few more minutes, and I'm just going to talk about the wise virgins. The attitude that they have. Remember, I'd said to you that attitude is more important. Attitude is more important than aptitude. Attitude speaks to your willingness to be able to do stuff. So attitude and aptitude, which is what you know, determines your altitude, how high or how far you go. And so the thing is, in this story, the Greek word that was translated as wise, you know what it means? It means someone who is prudent and able to make proper decisions. Somebody who is able to make proper decisions. As an adult, are you, if you look at your lives, we will see a pattern of sound decision making. How am I and how are you building up our capabilities to be able to make sound decisions on a regular basis? My boyfriend is slapping me 3 times a week, and I am praying that God will touch his heart, and we have been together for 3.5 years. Hallelujah. Amen. That is not sound decision making. One day, you will graduate from being the drum. You know this drum. You graduate from being the drum to become the football. Amen. So the ability to, and the word foolishness there, all right, means to be dull in mind. That's the Greek word. So you see the difference between the wise and the foolish is in their reasoning capacity. And the Bible talks about people who have built their senses through use. And so the capacity for sound decision making is something that I can learn, and it's something that you can learn as well. And it's something that this story is prompting us to learn. So the ability to make sound decisions is a proof of maturity. Another thing you will see is that the ability to schedule pain and pleasure is a proof of maturity. The ability to self-govern is a proof of maturity. So ask your neighbor for me, are you matured? Do you have the ability to make sound decisions? Do you have the ability to self-govern? Can you save money for your rent and not buy the ashwabi for the wedding? Yeah? Can you save money for your rent and not go on the vacation? And then the 5 wise virgins also, they demonstrated, they had the attitude of knowing when to be able to draw the line. They were firm and courageous. So when they said, give us, they said, no, we cannot give you. Somebody says, oh, but Pastor, the Bible says we should be generous. We should be kind to our neighbors. But you know, there's an interesting verse, I think, in Galatians chapter 5. It says, number one, bear one another's burden. Yeah? And then he also says, each person, yeah, should carry his own load. What he means is this. A burden is something that is obviously overpowering you. You need help to carry it. All of us will help you to carry it. The load is something that you're expected to have the capacity to carry. So I'm not going to join you to carry. So having oil in your lamp, being ready for your opportunity, is the load that you are supposed to carry by yourself. Studying for the professional exams to make sure that you pass it is a load that you're supposed to carry for yourself. You don't have money to pay for it, but you want to do it. It's a burden. We can help you carry it. But even after we have helped you to carry the burden and we have reduced it, then you must carry your own load. If we help you today to carry the burden and you demonstrate the capacity to be unable to carry your own load, next time that you come, we will tell you to go. Nobody will want to help you again. Hallelujah. And so you need to ensure that you are surrounded by the right people who can inspire you to greatness and to do the right things. The five wise virgins were willing to do the work ahead of time. They paid now and played later. I mean, you know, the truth is, you can either pay now and play later, or you can play now and pay later. Hallelujah. You can subject yourself to the discipline of doing the right things today and enjoy tomorrow, or you can enjoy today and then suffer tomorrow in old age. And so when the time for performance has come, the time for preparation has ended. That's all. Hallelujah. When exam, let's say exam is starting at 9 a.m. They gave you notice 3 weeks ago. 8:45 a.m., the time to memorize the formula has finished. The time now is to demonstrate that you already know the formula. Hallelujah. I remember when I was in university in those days, you know, you will find out that sometimes when they announce exams are coming and they bring out timetable, that's when all the students, you know, people that have not been studying and have been cursing while after the beginning of, that's when they will remember that something has gone wrong. And then they'll now come and say, we cannot do this exam. They increase school fees, something. And then they will be trying to cause trouble so that they can be a looter or riot. And then they will shut down the school. I mean, it worked a few times. It happened a few times. But there were a few other times that it didn't happen. Because they were not ready. They were not prepared. Hallelujah. So sometimes, a lack of resources, a lack of capacity to be disciplined, holds people back from achieving their dreams and the objective of God for their lives. That will not be your story in the name of Jesus. The wisdom of God to live as the wise, God is giving to you in the name of Jesus. The wisdom of God to live circumspectly, to be ready at all times, to be able to take advantage of opportunities, it will come upon you in the name of Jesus. Shall we rise up on our feet this evening? Let's spend a few minutes praying before we go home. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, so the first thing that you notice from that story is that maturity and capacity to recognize and do the needful is critical to success. And so I want you to pray tonight and ask that the Holy Spirit begins to work upon your character. All right, guys, can you put my confession slides of the first one? I want you to pray tonight that the Holy Spirit is working upon your character to be able to help you in the name of Jesus, to be able to build the right character, to be able to put your flesh under subjection such that you are able to do what God wants you to do when he wants you to do it. Can you go ahead and pray tonight in the name of Jesus? I want you to pray tonight in the name of Jesus. I want you to pray and say that I have an understanding heart to recognize opportunities, to take advantage of market trends. I have possessed the discipline to pay the price and do what is required. I have the ability to watch my steps and to understand what the master wants. I want you to pray tonight in the name of Jesus and receive that grace in the name of Jesus. I want you to pray for the grace to use your head and make the most of every chance that you get in the name of Jesus. That opportunities are not passing you by. You're not the foolish child that sleeps in harvest in the name of Jesus. Receive the strength and the grace of God to be able to take tough decisions, to be able to embark on tough assignments in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we have prayed. You see, sometimes a lack of resources is what prevents you from taking advantage of opportunities. And I want you to pray tonight in the name of Jesus that every time an opportunity shows up, God is giving you the resources and the capacity to attract the resources to be able to take advantage of those opportunities in the name of Jesus. I want you to say with me, I walk in the abundance of heaven. I have a revelation of abundance. An understanding of the workings of faith for resources. Therefore, I take advantage of opportunities and make the most of what God brings along my path. I attract resources. I receive favor and help from people all over the world. And you turn that to your prayer tonight in the name of Jesus. I don't want to know what area of your life you need resources right now to be able to take advantage of opportunities. I want to just call those things forth in the name of Jesus. Receive the strength of the Lord. Receive the grace of the Lord in the name of Jesus. I want you to pray tonight in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Finally tonight, see, one of the things that paralyzes initiative is fear. The Bible says God has not given us a spirit of fear. And I want you to say with me tonight, the Spirit of God is in me. Therefore, fear has no place in me and no power over me. I am strong, courageous, and bold, and I do exploits. I am empowered by the Holy Spirit, and I can do incredible things. I take advantage of opportunities and achieve awesome results. Can you go ahead and pray tonight in the name of Jesus? I want you to rebuke the spirit of fear. I want you to exercise courage. Speak to those things ahead of you that look like mountains. I want you to speak to them and tell them to move. I want you to declare in the name of Jesus that they're able to do much more than you can ask or think or imagine in the name of Jesus. I want you to receive the strength of the Lord in your mind. Receive the mental capacity to be able to attack difficult issues, challenging issues, and provide solutions to them in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we have prayed. All right, so I want to pray for someone tonight. You see, the people who are potentially, I mean, when I was praying this evening, the Holy Spirit sort of put this picture in my heart. People who are struggling with the guilt of missed opportunities. So somebody says, I have missed opportunities and it looks like I can't make progress anymore. No, God gives second chances. I want to pray for you tonight for restoration and for recovery of opportunities. That God will, I mean, those ones that you lost, God is bringing others your way in the name of Jesus. Can I ask you, just put your hands up this evening and let me pray with you. If you're also getting weary or tired of waiting, you're in a season of waiting, and it looks like you're about to give up. Nothing seems to be making sense. I want to pray with you tonight and receive the strength of the Lord in the name of Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for your children tonight. And I say by the reason of the Spirit of God, Lord, we ask for every single person who is walking and living under the guilt of missed opportunities due to carelessness. Father, tonight we speak strength into their minds. The Bible says if our conscience condemns us, God is greater than our conscience. And so tonight we say by the Spirit of God, receive soundness of mind in the name of Jesus. Receive the love of God in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we pray tonight for a turnaround, bringing fresh opportunities in the name of Jesus. New open doors in the name of Jesus. And Lord, for anybody who might be discouraged tonight, who says, I have been waiting in the season of preparation and it looks like opportunities are not coming. Father, tonight we speak strength unto them in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we ask, oh God, that Lord, you will hasten the manifestation of their seasons in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, because you've heard us. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. May I ask that you very quickly take your seat? I want you to take your seat very quickly. Hallelujah. All right, if you've been blessed tonight, can you put your hands together for Jesus? Can I ask that we just bow our heads? I want to say one more prayer. Now, if there's anyone here tonight, remember I started out by saying that this story really was Jesus demonstrating to us the relationship that he expects us to have with him. If there's anybody here tonight who doesn't have a relationship with Jesus, anybody who is not saved and is not born again, you haven't at any time in your life made a decision for Jesus to become your Lord and your Savior, I'm giving you an opportunity tonight to be able to do so very quickly. Can I ask that you just raise your right hand wherever you are? I want to pray with you. And if you're joining us online and you want to say this prayer, you're making this decision, can you go to the chat room and let one of our ministers know that you're over there? And so can I ask very quickly tonight, wherever you are, just lift your hands above your head. I want to pray with you in this auditorium in the name of Jesus. I want you to have newness of life so that your relationship with Jesus may be restored. And if you have done this before, but you are backslidden into sin, you're no longer living right, can I ask also that you just lift your hands up? Let me pray with you tonight. Let there be a restoration in your life in the name of Jesus. All right, if you're lifting your hands up, can you please stand up so I can see you? I want to be able to see you and know that you're raised saying this prayer. I want to pray with you. Can you just rise up on your feet tonight in the name of Jesus? Wherever you may be in the auditorium, can you just rise up very quickly? Don't waste time. Hallelujah. All right, thank you very much. God bless you for standing up over there. God bless you, the other person standing over there. Thank you very much. I want to pray with you. If you're online also, just join us in this prayer. Can you please say after me, Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to you tonight. I realize that I am a sinner and I ask that you forgive my sins. Lord, I ask that you will make me your child. I want you to be my Lord and my Savior. Save my soul and take me from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of your Son. Let me pray with you. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you. We know that heaven is rejoicing right now over the people who are making this decision. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask, oh God, that Lord, your hand rest upon them in the name of Jesus. Forgive them their sins. Cleanse them with the blood of Jesus. Break the hold of the nature of sin in their lives. Transform their nature into the nature of your child in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. All right, if you're standing up, you said that prayer, we thank congratulations. Please, I want you to carry everything that you brought to church. You will see one of our counselors beckoning to you. Please follow them very quickly. They will have a 5-minute chat with you. They want to give you a resource that will help you to grow in your faith. Can you just go with them very quickly? I want you to don't be ashamed. Just stand up wherever you are. Carry everything that you brought to church. Just